Hello and welcome to the latest installment of the Island Symphony Orchestra's Artists for Artists, a series of virtual masterclasses for amateur musicians and young aspiring musicians. My name is Eric Stewart. I'm the music director of the Island Symphony Orchestra, and we are thrilled today to welcome Lila Nystad of the New York Philharmonic. Before I introduce Lila, I would just like to point out that this presentation is made possible by a grant from the New York State Council on the Arts, with the support of Governor Cuomo and the New York State Legislature, and it is administered by the Huntington Arts Council. Here we are with Lila Nystad, Acting Associate Principal Horn of the New York Philharmonic. Welcome, Lila.
Thanks, Eric. It's great to be here.
Great. So first, I just wanted to mention that we actually met at Interlochen Arts Academy, and we both eventually found our way to New York City. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about your journey from there to New York City and eventually to becoming a horn player in the New York Philharmonic.
Yeah, absolutely. I think my journey up until the point where I went to Interlochen was pretty typical, maybe of a, I grew up in Michigan in the Midwest, so I was an Interlochen sort of local, but you know, I was a kid in band basically, and I started playing the horn in fifth grade. I had parents who encouraged me to do extracurriculars. So I wouldn't say I loved horn right away, but I loved the challenge of playing an instrument. I really took to it right away. I didn't practice a lot or anything, but I did like the sense of community. And because my parents were supportive and encouraging, I went to summer camps and I started taking lessons when I was in eighth grade, which ultimately led me to Interlochen, where I was a student at the same time as Eric there. And that was where my eyes sort of were opened to what was maybe beyond playing horn in high school. And I met other students for the first time who were looking to go on and do a music major, perhaps at college, or who were thinking seriously about universities and conservatories. So at Interlochen, I was kind of challenged to up my game and to really think seriously about what I wanted to do as a career. And I was just enjoying playing horn. And I thought, well, I should give it a go. I had other interests. And I went to the University of Wisconsin because I wanted to keep my options open as opposed to going to a conservatory. But I went for it as a music performance major to get a bachelor's degree. And I just kind of kept falling more and more in love with the experience of not only playing horn, but playing in ensembles. The thing that was always my favorite thing at camp and also at Interlochen was being in the school orchestras and bands, that sense of big ensemble stuff. So I had a sense when I went off to college that probably I was going to want to take auditions and try to go the orchestral route, which I did. And I got hungry very early on, and I took a lot of auditions starting when I was still a student for professional orchestras of different levels, some just regional orchestras, which were part-time things. And then as I got more serious for full-time jobs, I'm lucky that I had teachers along the way who just kind of said, just go for it. And if I wasn't going to go for it, they said, hey, maybe you should be looking into this opportunity. So some gentle prodding along the way to kind of keep looking for what was next as far as opportunities in horn. So I went off to summer festivals as a college student to try to meet other young players from different schools and see how I was stacking up against things. I ended up getting a master's degree from Yale University and taking bunches and bunches of auditions. And all told, I think my final tally was about 21 professional auditions by the time I got my job in the New York Philharmonic. It was just a matter of kind of like putting one foot in front of the other for a long time and doing my best to sort of not get discouraged. And when an opportunity didn't pan out, to sort of think of it as a learning opportunity, a chance to sort of, okay, notch some new opportunities and move on to the next one.
Yeah, that mindset is so important because, I mean, in this field, you can really get knocked down when a door that you really want to open doesn't open. Mm-hmm. But I also was wondering, is there
It sounds like your love for the instrument, your love for playing ensemble, it was just a gradual, it was like a snowballing effect rather than some sort of aha moment. Would you say that would be a way to put it?
Definitely, definitely. It was just a snowball effect. Totally. That's a great way to put it. It was just kind of a, okay, well, now what's next? I mean, I had no moment, some people have that story. Oh, I heard the horn. My parents took me to a kid's concert. I heard the horn. I thought that's for me. And it wasn't like that for me at all. I mean, I think even when I went to Interlock and I knew there were professional orchestras and I had never thought critically, well, how do those people get to be in that position? What's the career path like? It was never sort of on my radar. It was so gradual and it was just, well, I liked this experience. So let's see what else is next, whether that was school or masterclass opportunities or opportunities to travel and play in youth orchestras, things like that. So it was just, that gradual, I was in it, so deep by the time I was like, wow, this is going to happen. Yeah.
But that leads me to another idea, another thought, which is a lot of people who do have that aha moment, that's kind of when something clicks and then they say, now I have to spend X amount of hours a day practicing and that's all they do. What was it for you that, I guess, got you to the point where, or was there a certain point where you started practicing way more, or were you just always, loved to practice? You were always wanted to, or you said at first you didn't love to practice so much.
I didn't. I would do it on my own, I have a younger brother who was forced to play the trombone because we all had to try a band instrument and he had to practice 10 minutes per day, which always, the 10 minutes always ended up including the time it took him to unpack the trombone from the case and everything like that. So I would sit and do it, but to practice seriously, maybe when I was at Interlochen and other people were doing that. And I started to perceive the benefit in that as well, where I would be in the practice room long enough to have a breakthrough or the moments where I could figure something out on my own in the practice room and it wouldn't have to be my teacher at the time telling me something, and starting to discover for myself sort of the joy and the feeling of accomplishment in personal practice. And maybe when I went off to a couple summer festivals when I was in the midst of my undergraduate career, just that feeling of being surrounded by other people who were doing that too. And I thought, oh, okay, there's something to this.
Okay.
For sure. Yeah, but I mean, I was getting serious in high school and then I remember and that started me on really experiencing a few moments where there was a lot of actual joy and accomplishment in practicing, but it was kind of hard earned, I think.
Okay. Yeah. That's really fascinating. It just because for so many, you hear about the process being so arduous, being so, now I have to, it's like a form of self-torture, but it's very refreshing to hear, somebody who it was just kind of, the whole scene seems like a very healthy take on it and a very healthy, just, approach to it, a very holistic, I would almost say. So,
yeah. And I think I was lucky to have met the right teachers along the way who were really demanding in the right ways, but also were not pressuring me to follow their prescribed path where they had gone, and who were really, really, dealt with each of their students as individuals. And so they nudged me again in the right directions and were sort of able to meet me in terms of where my strengths were and where their expertise was. And it was collaborative, I would say, the sort of musical education that I have. So that helped because I felt like I was doing it for myself under their very expert guidance, which was the magic of having good teachers. They made me feel like I was sort of they were leading me to these moments of self-discovery and these moments of self-empowerment, which I can't thank them enough for. So, but it ended up being a very sort of organic way to come into music. I was never practicing. Well, probably a little bit. I was practicing to you know, please your teacher, make your teacher proud. But ultimately, you know, it wasn't about that. It wasn't because I was told this was what I knew, that's what I had to do, but it wasn't just for the sake of that's what you have to do, so you do it. It was always with a sense of beyond that is something more, right? Is something at the core of the purpose of why we want to do this, why we want to study music at a high level.
Absolutely. And, yeah. And you are very clear about, you know, how important good teachers are and the right attitude and the way to approach each student of it individually. That's a wonderful thing. That's really wonderful. Yeah. So speaking of practicing and yes. those sort of technical things, the people in the Island Symphony Orchestra, my orchestra, they know I have a great affinity for your instruments. And I love the capabilities it has to produce huge, enormous sounds, but also the most sweet and delicate lines. And you know, it can be accompanying in a choir, and it can be so delicate and so just glassy and so just incredible sounds, and then it can take over the entire orchestra. And technically, to achieve those two ends of the spectrum, I know from my own experience as a hobbyist horn player that it mm-hmm. takes such incredible control to do both ends of the spectrum. And I'm just mm-hmm. wondering if there are, I guess, exercises, practice techniques in order to help, I guess, keep both ends of the spectrum intact for maybe an amateur player or an aspiring young professional.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And that is the thing when I got into the New York Philharmonic, I was so stretched and exactly what you just said. I couldn't play loud enough and I couldn't play soft enough. You know, my extremes on the spectrum were just like not there. So I had to learn how to do that. And one of my favorite things with that, I love doing long tones. Well, I don't love doing long tones. Some days I love them, but they are our sort of strongest medicine, maybe as brass players. And long tones help me with my stability, really. It allows you that time. You're just going to take a very good, healthy breath. It allows you to examine how your breathing is going for that day. And then just to produce a tone and sit there and live with a tone and get inside it. And try to hear it for what it is, the resonance and the overtones and the feeling. And then there's infinite flexibility with that. Like I'll do long tones where I do a really long crescendo over the course of it and try to kind of start softer every day and get louder at the end, you know, where I create dynamic fluctuations where I'm trying to sort of test myself on these extremes, all while just without doing anything technical, right? Where I'm just thinking about what is the quality of the sound that I'm making. So that was probably one thing that really helped me as far as being able to do those extremes. Another thing is sort of to play in different acoustics. I think this is really important, even if it's like going into a different room in your house. I'll do that sometimes because where I practice at home and really have been spending most of the last year and a half practicing, it's a very dry space that I've put in acoustical foam and things just to protect my hearing and keep my sanity. But, you know, if things are starting to feel a little closed in, I'll just go out in the living room where, you know, it's more bare walls and I'll let the sound sort of bounce off of that. I'm really lucky in my job because when the Philharmonic is playing, we're on stage for both our rehearsals and our concerts, and we're in this massive acoustic all the time. So it gives you a chance to test that out. So I think even if it's like bringing your instrument outdoors or into some sort of big space, that's so valuable because you'll realize maybe some of the limitations of what you're used to hearing. And we all get into sort of bad habits accommodating the acoustic we get used to. So it's good. Sometimes it's not you, it's just your reaction to the space that you're in. And you just need sort of to zoom out or zoom in as far as what you're doing with your own sound production. And the last thing I would say about that is definitely these extremes of range and likewise extremes of dynamic, but also extremes of range for players. It's sort of a use it or lose it type of situation where you have to sort of challenge yourself to go to those levels. There's no sort of saving it for when you need it. I remember when I went off to college, I couldn't really play in the high range. Like I could get up there, but I wasn't confident there. And my teacher said, well, do you practice there? And I said, no, I'm saving it for when I need it. He's like, well, you can't really save what you haven't worked to cultivate. So not being afraid, even in the practice room or even on your own, to test yourself as far as those extremes, because then you'll have it in your toolkit when you need it, when you get into the larger ensemble like the orchestra.
Okay.
So, yeah.
And another thing, I like what you said about playing in different spaces, because I think there's also there can be a tendency maybe to want to play in a space that makes you sound really good and hides some things that you don't want to hear. And then the other side of that, if you're playing in a space that is just so dead and you're not doing it with the purpose of, you know, putting everything under a microscope, you might not be the most inspiring thing. And you might just like, you know, I'm done with that.
Right.
So, exactly. So I really love that idea. Yeah. And I think, and with an instrument like the horn, which is so portable, comparatively speaking,
right.
Like I can't walk around with this thing everywhere, but, okay. Yeah. I think that's really great advice and practical on so many different levels.
Yeah.
And, now speaking of, I guess the capabilities of your instrument. Mm-hmm. And I guess people in my orchestra know that I love when the brass produces when at appropriate moments, a very big sound that just kind of, you know, just, you feel it throughout your entire, the waves flow through your whole body.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, I'm sure that is, you know, some of the most fun music to play. But I know that for some, I've noticed some who are not totally comfortable with producing that big sound, maybe they can be, you know, there's two sides of the coin. Some might be timid to produce that sound, and some might be a little overzealous and take it past the point where it starts to then get a little, it might sort of not sound as beautiful as it could. And what is the key to finding that balance where it's the biggest sound, yet it's just, it's stable, it's, you know, supported, et cetera. Mm-hmm. What would you say are some good ways to develop that?
Yeah, I think it's all about air and how you use your air. And we're definitely speaking the same language as far as what you like in your orchestra and what we like in my orchestra. This is our New York tradition, right? We like it big and we like it that heavy, glowing brass sound. It's the best thing. And exactly like you said, Eric, we don't like it to tip over to that edge where you get that sort of really edgy, brassy sound, you know, really metallic sound. We like to keep it with that aura of sound. And so for me, that all comes from the air and being comfortable in how you use your air support. So it's not just the quantity of air, right? Because you push too much air and you go over that boundary where you lose that quality of sound, that core, that beautiful core. But maybe more than any other mechanical aspect, it is that air. So first of all, tension is never your friend in that. So it's getting used to taking in the air, taking in a huge volume of air, but staying relatively relaxed in the rest of your body. When I first started playing with the Philharmonic, I was really trying to keep up, you know, with these brass players and with these heavy hitters, you know, in the brass playing world. And I was working so hard and the tension was not actually giving me any more volume or any more projection of sound. So what I had to learn to do was breathe and stay sort of heavy in my seat and feel really grounded sitting there. And same thing if you're standing up to play, feeling grounded into your feet. So a sort of low center of gravity helps. Yeah, that's where it's got to start. From there, whether it's a loud dynamic or a soft dynamic, I still want that huge sound. Like, you know, I still, even in the softest dynamic, you want that sound to carry through, right? That projection of the sound. So for me, it's about taking in the air and keeping the air in motion. That's really something I think about a lot. So in order to do that, you really have to think about your air support. So when I breathe in and I feel that expansion in my rib cage and my sternum and my back, what I try to do is then keep that feeling of sort of flared engagement of the muscles, even as I'm exhaling and even as I'm pushing the air, because then I know the air has enough pressure behind it to stay in motion. So when it's loud, you've got a great volume of air moving, maybe faster. When it's soft, it's less volume of air, but that sound's got to keep moving. The minute our air stops, we all know that it backs up on you and you lose the control. So it's about learning how to maintain that feeling of activated pressure and outward. I like to think that I breathe in and my diaphragm sort of stays upward and maybe outward. And everybody's a little bit different. But so on the one hand, low center of gravity, and then an air supply that's kind of excited and lifted upwards. And that to me is what gives you the flexibility in your sound and what gives you that sort of just that quality that we're looking for, where it has that beautiful core to it, but that great power behind it as well. So learn how to like use your air and look for places where you hold tension in your body. Cause as efficient, you also gotta be efficient, right? Then you can really use your air only towards playing. That's what I would say. Yeah. Thinking about air all the time. How can you use it?
Mm-hmm. And you touched on something that, you know, the responsible musician and teacher will always bring up, which I didn't have in the question, but playing softly and the fact that the use of air when you play soft, I also conduct choruses. So it's the exact same thing for singers. The use of air when you are singing or playing softly, it has to be that exact same, I guess, attention to detail, I think is what you were saying. You have to keep that, the sense of, because I know that, let's say some maybe players who are not professionals, sometimes there's a tendency to see a dynamic like pianissimo and say, that means that I just, whether you're a string player, but that means I just, you know, just kind of relax and just, but the thing is to, like you said, to make it beautiful and to make it full, you have to still have that full, like you said, full, you know, capacity of air and keep it moving. Mm-hmm. And because then you can play wherever you want on the dynamic range, I think, like you said, but you get that full quality and you get a sound that fills the space and your description of it.
Right. Yeah. I tell my students to kind of, you know, go back to when you first learned about when we were doing graphs and math class and things like that, where you have the y-axis and the x-axis. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe we fall into the trap of thinking that x-axis is sort of the mezzo forte middle, but actually you want that to be at the bottom, and, you know, piano is down here and forte is up here on the y-axis, but you never want your graph to dip below zero, right? Because that's where you lose the note. That's where you lose control. So always kind of keeping it above zero. You got to always kind of keep it alive. And we talk about that a lot in lessons, how to keep the sound alive, keep it living, keep it moving. And that's how you maintain the soft dynamics. And then you grow, you can grow into the large dynamics too. So we never want to dip below. We don't want to go sub, sub P. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
I like that. Yeah. Okay. So now, speaking of, I guess, the, you know, professional players who play with ensembles and then amateur players who may play in community groups, there are some big differences people might point out is that professionals are so aware of when they're playing an ensemble, every other voice that's going on, how their part fits into that. And I was wondering, particular to your instruments, Is there advice you could give to amateur players beyond just studying a score or listening to the piece, how to, I guess, envision their sound fitting in with the rest of the ensemble in different, less maybe common contexts?
That's a really great question. And I'm so glad you said score study and listening, because that's where it all starts, right? That's what gives you the working knowledge and of the piece and tells you what you should be listening for, you know, and it's going to give you those clues about what you might need to be hearing. And with that too, I study scores all the time. I love it. I don't feel comfortable really going in to play and rehearse a piece if I haven't looked at the score, unless we're doing like a world premiere and I just can't get my hands on the music, you know, but anything standard rep, I've got the score and I've looked at it along with the recording. So I kind of know what I'm supposed to be listening for. And that really aids my listening. But beyond that, I find it really helpful to think of blending and ensemble playing sort of beyond just intonation. I think we think about sharp or flat, things like that. But I try to think about things in terms of timbre and tone and color of sound is one thing. Even when I'm trying to play like in tune or with other people, you know, you probably had somebody say to you, you try to get inside the sound of the person you're playing with. So really, as you're playing, extending your ears, making the effort to another instrument and identify what is their sound, you know, what is that sound and how can I support that? It takes practice, but it does take sort of that ability to know where to put your ears or to be able to sit there and manage your own part. And I think it of course, it takes a lot of preparation on your own part because you can't be fumbling for the next note. You got to be pretty secure in what you're doing to be then able to actively try to start maybe putting your ears, you know, in the sections around you. For me, it's always clarinets and bassoons. I can always hear them. I know they're my buddies in the score and in the section, but then trying to push out a little farther. Okay. So can I hear the flutes? Can I hear the oboe? Can I hear the violins? Can I really hear what they're doing? And can I let go of this idea that I'm constantly evaluating where I am in relation to pitch with them, but can I start thinking about, okay, what happens if I make my sound a little warmer? What happens if I get a little softer? Oh, you know, it's those amazing things where sometimes intonation issues get fixed by just changing the balance of certain things. So kind of going fishing a little bit with different elements of your playing and not just saying, oh, it doesn't blend. Oh gosh, I'm just going to, you know, but experimenting with the different parameters of your playing to try to, you know, fit more into this kaleidoscope of orchestral sound, I think is really important. So there are all these factors at play. There's all these tools at your disposal when you're talking about fitting into a section. I also, one thing that I think a lot about, and I sort of inherited from the approach of the New York Philharmonic brass section, was to think about how everything you do related to playing in the course of playing is relaying information to your colleagues around you. So it really isn't just where you start a note. Also, where you end a note is transmitting information to your colleagues. You know, how you articulate, your consistency with which you interpret different markings in the music. All of this is sending out the nonverbal information to your colleagues. So one thing we really talk about, because you know we're the horn section, and I'm the biggest mover in the section, and everybody else plays with the horn bell on their leg, and they're very still when they play. There's no cueing like this, you know. So what's important for us is to be really intentional about our breaths, where you start the breath, what the quality of the breath is, if it's fast or slow, appropriate to the music, and then also where we cut off together. Because if you clearly defined silences as clearly as you define the notes themselves, you've got all the information you need to play it perfectly in lockstep with your colleagues. So I think notice those details in your playing, coming into rehearsals with a really good plan about what you're going to do as far as the articulation. This is that articulation. This is that style. This is this. This is where I'm going to breathe here. Especially if you're a principal player, it's kind of the best thing you can do for your section is to be consistent and give everyone else the chance to come with you as far as the group approach. And then also thinking about where you ending notes with precision, ending notes with intention. That is so powerful for how you fit in to the rest of the orchestra. And when you start to notice those things in yourself and where you've made decisions like that, you'll start to hear other people who have made those decisions as well, and you can respond to them. So so I think that's really important. Just know that you're always giving information and you're always getting information from everybody around you, whether you sort of, and a lot of it maybe is subconscious too. That's the longer we play, the more experience we have, the more it becomes sort of second nature. So
yeah, it's really interesting. It's almost like if you just talk about basic human interaction, it's kind of like there's body language that you can pick up on. And that's kind of like the musical version of body language, but but it's more like articulation language, cutoff language. Mm-hmm. And I'm so glad you mentioned cutoffs, because it's one of those things that, you know, might not be the first thing people think about when they're practicing or even envisioning a piece, how it's supposed to sound. But back to what you said about, blending and listening to other instruments that, let's say you're playing with them. I mean, mm-hmm. many passages you may have horns with celli, let's say. And sometimes I would just take for granted, as I was studying and learning new music and hearing concerts, listening to recordings, I would say, wow, the way that orchestra, it blends so well. And I almost took it for granted that those two instrument combinations work so well together, let's say, along with other ones. But then, you know, sometimes I'm in certain contexts, let's say I'm writing a piece or I'm rehearsing a group, and I'm thinking, why isn't that working the way it did at that concert? And it's like you said, sometimes it's beyond just, this is a great combination. The players need to just be so in tune with each other to make, the composer gives you the tools, but then you have to, you know, take that next step. It's sound, and I like the way you said that.
Yeah. And it was, gosh, when I first started playing with the Philharmonic, it was, I didn't have too much professional experience before then. You know, I started subbing with the Philharmonic early on, and I had played with regional orchestras, but it was my first time playing with a full-time professional 52-week orchestra. And it was just so much sensory overload. I mean, I knew immediately, I was like, wow, I am so in my own head. You know, like I am so preoccupied with just learning my part. And I was like, okay, I know that I'm going to have to learn to relax and learn to look outwards. But it took a little bit of time, but I could feel immediately, okay, this is hard. You know, like this is a lot of information to process. And right now I can barely see past my stand, you know, because I'm just focusing so hard. And it's something that did get easier and easier with time and just an awareness. So like everything else in music, it takes practice, right? There's literally like nothing about being a musician that you don't have to practice.
Yeah.
That's also the great joy of it, the great privilege of it, that we do have a thing that we do where you can always get better and you can always learn something new. That's so cool. It's so exciting. Yeah.
Yeah. We never arrive.
Right. You never arrive. And that's a good thing, right? As long as you can be happy with that. Yeah.
Right.
Music will just continue to give meaning to your life. And yeah, I think it's so wonderful.
Absolutely. Now, speaking of the fun, exciting things about music, your personal tastes, mm-hmm. I'm just curious, what would you say are some of your favorite pieces to play from genres, let's say solo music, chamber music, orchestral rep?
My favorite piece of music is the Benjamin Britten Serenade for tenor, voice, horn, and strings. And doesn't have anything to do with the fact that it's a beautiful horn part. I just love that piece. I think it's a masterpiece of text setting, and it's haunting and beautiful, and it just kind of hits you right in the guts, you know, I think, gosh, I should know, but maybe it's six poems all set to music, sung by a tenor. And then horn has this sort of obligato part and with the string orchestra, but all the texts are sort of musing on the idea of the end of the day as sort of a parallel to the journey of life. And so some of them are very dark, some of them are kind of wistful, but it's just a beautiful piece. And I love it so much. I always love hearing it as far as solo pieces, but I mean, with the orchestra, it's just like, how do you even choose? But I love Strauss. I mean, just the way he wrote for the horn, the sort of the understanding he has of that instrument. Nobody, Eric, I'm sure you feel the same way, but I mean, he's such a model of how to write for that instrument, and just, yeah, it's amazing. So it's so much fun to play. It's so rewarding to play a Strauss tone poem, like an Alpine symphony. So great. I mean, all his opera music too. I love the opera stuff. I hope I get some chances, even though I'm a symphony orchestra player, I hope I get some chances to play some of the operatic music. Love playing a Mahler symphony. I love Stravinsky. I could play, I could either play Mahler's First Symphony, Bruckner's Eighth, or The Rite of Spring by Stravinsky at every concert for the rest of my career and be pretty happy with that. Those pieces just don't get old. I hope that the orchestra will play more Thomas Addis pieces.
Oh, yes. Sure.
I think he's great. And he writes for big orchestra, or can. He writes for all sorts of things, but he's written some really amazing stuff for a huge orchestra. And I love his language. I think it's just really challenging, but really, really effective. So there are so many great composers. I mean, so many new voices now, and it's almost like I feel like my new favorite piece, I might not even have heard it yet, but it's out there, like waiting to be discovered. So there's so many. I mean, it's so hard to pick because there's so much variety. It's amazing. And then I love chamber music. I love orchestra is my one true love. And then chamber music is great. And my bucket list ones are, there's a Dohnányi sextet for three winds, three strings and piano. And then there's also a beautiful nonette, again, for mixed winds and strings and piano by Samuel Coleridge Taylor. And that's on my bucket list. But I love doing like mixed winds, strings, that sort of thing for chamber music. So yeah, those are
awesome. But,
yeah, so much variety, so much to listen to, so much to choose from. I mean, I'll be listening for the rest of my life. Yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned Bruckner 8. I believe I was at the concert where, were you playing first Wagner tuba?
I was, yes, yes. Recently we did that. Yeah. Oh, that was so much fun. Yeah. Wagner tuba is a little bit of a beast to play, but Bruckner wrote so beautifully. He wrote four part chorales for the Wagner tubas, which are sort of between a horn and a trombone is the easiest way to describe it. But so we pulled those out maybe once a season. They look like little tubas with the bell up above our heads and get to play something like Bruckner. So a little bit scary, very rewarding. I love the challenge. Well,
the sound that comes out of them is a gem, I think, of the orchestral world. So
I think so too. Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, why don't you introduce the first piece? I'm very happy that you chose this piece to play. It's along the lines that the Island Symphony Orchestra is trying to explore more, which is underrepresented composers. So why don't you tell us about the first piece that we're going to hear you play?
Yeah, so the first piece is called Sonatina for horn and piano, and it's by Ruth Gipps, who was a British composer. She actually, what I think, 1921 to 1999. So she's almost contemporary. I discovered her music because I inherited a stack of horn music from a previous teacher. And that was and I was looking to create a recital of works by women. And I pulled this piece out, and it's just so charming. It's three movements, all very brief, but just beautiful sort of miniatures, colorful writing. She was a piano prodigy and played a lot of other different instruments, and she composed. I think she sent off her first piece to be published before she was even maybe 10 years old or something. Wow. So quite a gifted musician all around. And, but really in the course of her career was not offered any opportunities because she was a woman mm-hmm. at a time when there were no opportunities. And in fact, I think sort of she maybe developed sort of a tough exterior on the basis mm-hmm. of kind of always being told that it was very presumptuous for a woman like her to be so talented, quite wow. so, you know, accomplished and things like that. So, but she wrote this sonatina. She's written a lot of orchestral works that I'm actually not familiar with. I'm learning a little bit more. She wrote a horn concerto, but this piece, this sonatina is recently back in print, and it's really, really fun to put together with a pianist. I find it's not doesn't stretch you too far in terms of endurance mm-hmm. or range and anything like that. So it's a great piece to dive into as from a chamber music perspective and just really, really rewarding to play. So that's the Sonatina, Opus 56.
All right, let's have a listen.
Great. The book.
break, and we have one more piece that we can hear you play. And what are we going to listen to next?
This is one of our classics in the horn repertoire. This is Franz Strauss's Nocturne, his Opus 7. So Franz Strauss was himself a horn player and the father of Richard Strauss, who, as you know, my favorite. But Franz Strauss was, he was an opera pit player, and many of Wagner's operas he was playing the premieres of these, so quite an accomplished player. And this is just another wonderful piece in our repertoire. It's called Nocturne, so it's sort of a serenade, if you will, just a classic ABA form for a horn and piano, but kind of one of a gem in early valved horn writing for just the lyricism of the horn. So this is like, everybody's got to learn this piece at some point, right? Because it's just beautiful. And I want to give a shout out to my pianist, Justine, who's a wonderful friend, and we know each other from our work at Rutgers, but we have never played together until we made these videos, but she's played for all my students. And I've always thought, oh God, I got to do something with Justine. So we got together and recorded these, and we just had such a good time. And that Strauss in particular is something we both played a million times, but it just doesn't get old. And it's so special when you both know your parts and the other part to a piece so well, and it really does feel like play. So thanks to Justine for her wonderful collaborative playing, and just for making this beautiful piece just a joy to put together. So
all right,
Nocturne,
let's have a listen.
Thank you. And we're back with Leilani. It's so wonderful to hear you play Brava.
Thank you.
And we're getting some in the chats. We're getting questions or more like comments like, wow, it sounds so good. I wish I sounded like that. So I wanted to ask from a standpoint of, let's say, when you are thinking of a phrase and thinking of how you want the sound of a phrase, for me personally, at first, when I approach the instrument, when you hear each note kind of bloom and you hear the attack of each note, even if it's legato, each note seems to have its own shape to it. But I'm wondering, when you think of a phrase, a legato phrase, let's say, is there a way you envision the shape of each note, or more like a stream of notes and a constant, because obviously it's important to keep that air going. I was wondering if you could talk about that, the shape of the notes.
Yeah, definitely. I think that when we think about note shapes, we tend to give a lot of attention to the front of the notes and how the notes begin. And this is maybe a little bit of a callback to what I was speaking about earlier in terms of the note endings giving so much information. Mm-hmm. And so for me, it's really important that I think about how to get through a note and into the next note. And that's actually, from a technical perspective, that's very important for me, because I have this tendency, which a lot of brass players have, where we call it a twa-twa, where you tend to kind of land on the note and then beautify the sound. But what you end up getting is a wah-wah kind of effect, where the notes have like the reverse shape of what you want. So for me, I have to plan both how I'm going to start the note, and then I'm going to move through the note and into the next note. So I imagine notes having bodies. They have beginnings and ends, and in the middle, they have something that happens. So if I can get really into what's happening in the middle, that helps me to be sort of in the moment, in the phrase, I would say, because I feel like I'm just at one point in time traveling linearly through the phrase. I don't get hung up on kind of each note as it comes individually. So always thinking through the notes and not to the notes is a big one I do. And I think ultimately that unlocks, you know, people always say, oh, play it like you would sing it. And I have a really hard time making that translation in the abstract. You know, I mean, it's just so different. So that for me, makes me feel like I get closer to what it is to sing through the instrument, if I'm thinking of beginning, middle, and end.
Okay. And I think it's an interesting concept, because the way the instrument sounds, the way the notes bloom just naturally, I don't know, the acoustic resonance, it almost seems like they each have that, like you said, the twa twa. So it's almost, maybe it's a counterintuitive, but you have to realize that you don't need to affect the sound the sound naturally has this bloom. So yes, it's like you said, more just thinking about all the way through. I think that's an important thing to And even with it, whether it's like you said, you know, legato phrases, but also, you know, if it's not completely legato, still that the direction and everything, mm-hmm, the ends of each note.
Yeah.
Let's see. If we have any other questions, I have a question about, let's talk about when you have an attack, mm-hmm, that is a little bit more of an accent.
Yeah.
And, you know, and especially if it's when you put a little more force behind it and there's a little crunch to it, let's say, what would you say is the key to, you know, sometimes that's when, you know, it takes everything being, I think, very controlled, and mm-hmm, it's possible to lose control of the notes, even with other brass instruments, other wind instruments. I'm wondering about controlling those accents to keep everything steady, the pitch steady, the sound. If you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. Articulation variation is something that it can make a performance so special if you have that in your arsenal, like different ways to attack the notes. And to keep control of it is really the thing, because what I experience a lot, what I hear in my students, is that we get really tongue heavy with the front of the note, and we try to actually use the tongue to carve out the different types of accents. So we even say like tongue harder, you know, for an accent, that sort of thing, for a sforzando, tongue harder, which maybe really isn't that useful, because it still all comes from the airstream, and the tongue can't be the thing that pushes the air out into the instrument. And that's for me where I lose control, is if I get too much like ta, you know, and then the air is coming behind the tongue. It's more getting that coordination. So I think of the tongue as releasing the air as a valve instead of initiating the air. So what that means is sort of maybe more compression of air behind the tongue, more excited air ready to go, especially as you're going for the more aggressive accents, your, you know, kind of wedges and carrots and SFs and SFZs and all these things. So having that volume of tongue, and then the tongue really just releases versus kind of, you know, the airstream is going and the tongue comes to like force it through. So mm-hmm. getting that coordination right is really important. So sometimes I'll practice without actually using the tongue, but trying to get the effect or trying to get the coordination with only the airstream, doing like a breath attack, we would say. And that's useful, especially useful in soft dynamics, but you can do it also in louder dynamics and more aggressive things, just to make sure that the air is actually present in the equation and not like the secondary feature. So tongue is secondary. Tongue is like for wind players, I think it's that part of technique that really likes to take on more authority than it should have. So we always have to be reminding the tongue that it's kind of a blunt instrument, and our refinement and our expressive capability comes from how we use our air and our support, and tongue is less important.
Okay. Yeah. I think that's really good advice about trying different ways of starting a note without the tongue, as you said. And we have a question here. Do you set your embouchure before starting the air?
That's a loaded question, right? So there are a couple different schools with that. I do to some extent. There's kind of one extreme where really you're kind of just air in and air out, and it's very fluid. There's no hesitation. There's other schools where it's really kind of breathe in. If we call it breathe, set, play, because you're breathing in, get everything in place while you sort of, the air almost pauses at the top and then release. And while you're pausing with the air, you're getting everything tucked in. I do find I do a little bit, maybe more in this direction towards the breathe, set, play. Yeah. Always pray. Yes. On a brass instrument, but yeah. So breathing in at the top, as I imagine the air sort of turning around almost like a figure eight as it's coming out. And at that moment, things are starting to focus in towards the center. And at the moment of, then at that point, that's the moment of the greatest amount of focus when that air is ready to go. So I try to keep it, or the feeling, I try to keep the feeling of the embouchure and everything flexible, maybe in motion a little bit, just as the air is staying in motion. But for me, definitely, there are certain times where I'll go more towards setting the embouchure in advance. Maybe if an entrance is really sort of delicate or soft, and I really need that moment to sort of make sure that the lips are going to vibrate fast enough and close enough together to get a high note out, I'll take a little bit more time in the set. But the important thing is to not either tighten up and not feel like everything maybe comes back as you draw in the air and then stops. So maybe breathing in, when there's a little bit of like intensity crackling behind the air where everything kind of starts to move forward again, even as you are getting everything set on the surface. So a little bit of both.
Okay.
So yeah.
It's really fascinating. And hopefully this analogy isn't lost on many of those who have no interest in sports, but there's a lot of motions in sports or athletics where you see very successful athletes. Some it's just all one smooth motion, like a tennis serve, which all just happens at once. And then some there's like a hitch in it. And I wonder if that's an analogous type of thing.
I would think so. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
And the other nice parallel to sports, you know, I don't really like do running and yoga, but in my mind, like I imagine like how tennis works and baseball and golf and all these things. And it's really just all kind of abstract in my head, but based on kind of what I see. But, you know, if you think about like a golf swing, which of course, that's what people tell me you really practice, right? You practice your swing, but there are all these elements to it. Ultimately, it's one motion, but there are drills and there are ways you practice the various little little components of it. And it's the same thing like with the breathing and setting to play, you know, and many aspects of horn playing. So the ultimate thing is you want to provide something that works for you, that that gives you right. the best result, and that is that you've are extremely practiced at.
Okay, that's I like it. Now let's see. Any other questions? I have a question of
playing throughout the range of the instrument and any.
Sorry, I had a little audio issue there. That was way back. Playing throughout the range of the instrument, any techniques just the practice wise to so that because sometimes I know that certain adjustments are needed for extremes, but you know going through and just what ways to kind of tackle that and keep that as you know.
Yeah, a big one is just to do it and to as much as you can play over and through these kind mm-hmm. of different ranges of the horn. In horn playing, we talk about having a break. A lot of people have a range down at the bottom of the treble clef staff or just below where they do feel like a big shift happens. Kind of the shift is either in maybe how much weight is on the top lip from the mouthpiece versus the bottom lip, that sort of thing, or where the air direction goes. Like I know exactly where my break is. And it can be disruptive. So it's important to practice over that. And as you're practicing, I have like a lot of exercises that are slurs on the harmonic series, things like this that go over it or tonguing around in there. And the point is like not to sound good at it every day. The point is to work through it every day. So I have a lot of exercises where like it's really up and down. Like I don't really love doing them in public because it's really me working through the physicality of being able to get into that flexibility. It takes maintenance, it takes regular maintenance. I lose that range if I'm not doing it regularly, even if I'm playing a lot, but I'm not sort of focusing on my mid range, which is my transition range. I tend to sort of lose the strength in there. So consistency of working on it and also having a little bit of patience to work through, like nothing is going to be overnight. It like with exactly what you're talking about, Eric, going over and across the ranges, it is going to be a process and there's no quick fix for it. I do a lot. I do some like trumpet calisthenics. I don't know if any trumpet players in the group have done the Thompson buzzing book, but I love this. And I have an adaptation for horn, which I do, which is a lot of kind of like struggling along just to do very simple patterns. First, like buzzing on the mouthpiece, just slurring down across these transition ranges without over manipulating, discovering the simplest way to move through, and then you do it again on the horn. And they're still massively frustrating because you feel like you're back to a beginner every time they come out, but it gradually builds that strength. So I think patience with it and finding exercises. So slurs are really, really great for this because the exercises that make you use your air constantly. So I would say that doing things on the mouthpiece and then doing things back on your instrument for a brass player are really, really helpful in that because the mouthpiece is going to take away all the resistance and all the overtones, which sort of lock you into pitch in certain ways. And the mouthpiece is going to help you sort of smooth over those things. And then going for that same flexibility when you go back to the horn and letting things sort of happen really naturally, pitches bending and falling on and off notes and things like that. But just what you're doing is building that stability. I feel like it's all right here in that orbicularis oris. Am I right about that? All the muscles that help maintain that inward force of the embouchure. If those are kind of strong and supple, not tight, but able to be worked, like that's going to give you that ability to move in and out of the ranges. So like the springs on those mini trampolines, that's kind of what I imagine that to be like. So supporting, but giving you the range of motion that you need.
Okay, I like that. I think you've given us plenty to think about, plenty to practice, and you've played some beautiful music for us. We've been delighted to have you. And everybody, you can see Leila Nisterra playing with the New York Philharmonic this fall, unless you happen to catch them this summer. But we will all look forward to that. And thank you again for doing this. And that's all we have for today.
Yeah, it's been great to catch up, Eric, and to chat about music. And thank you for having me. It's been really, really fun to talk shop.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. My pleasure. Our pleasure. So I want to thank everybody for tuning in. And we will see you on the next installment.
Great.
Bye-bye.
Bye.